you know, the president uses his economic reality as a family to make sure that his own children have choice, which he should.
You see that all over the country, don't you?
Well, it's hypocrisy. I mean, that's what it is.
You'll call it that.
Yeah, it is hypocrisy. I mean, there's no, that's what it is. I mean, you can't like use choice for your own children and know the value of it. And then at the same time, so, oh yeah, but we can't provide that for low income and working class people.
Great Howard Fuller, thanks for joining us on Choice Media. I am an unbiased, I'm a biased interviewer on this because you are both so smart and so likable. I resent you very much for that. It's a combination I find a lot of envy in. But thanks for coming. We appreciate it.
Oh, no, it's my pleasure. I appreciate the invite.
Your book is called No Struggle, No Progress, A Warrior's Life from Black Power to Education Reform. And for some, this would seem like a disconnect of two things, right? And that when they think of the struggle of black power, they think of probably a different set of people than they normally think of with education reform. Am I right?
Well, maybe. And I think that that may be also a problem because one of the things I'm really concerned about with the ed reform movement is I think that people are doing some phenomenal work out there for kids and all over this country, you know, and I've been all over this country before the book tour and during the book tour. And you see these fantastic schools that have been created for kids, and you see kids getting a level of education that they never had before. You see low-income and working-class parents have choices that they've never had before. But at the same time, in many of these places, there's a disconnect between the ed reform community and the communities that we're trying to serve. Because education really is about liberation and freedom. And the people who are being liberated have to be a critical part of their own liberation. And so our ability to connect ed reform to the communities that we serve so that those communities are empowered to make critical decisions about what's happening to their children is going to be the thing that's going to determine, I think, the long-term sustainability of the work that we're doing.
And some of the people involved in those communities get jobs through the existing establishment education system, right?
Yeah, well, educational institutions are both educational entities, but they're also economic entities. And so if you look at a school district, for example, in many places, school districts have been the entree for black people to the middle class. I mean, principals and district people and et cetera. And what there is that there's a feeling that the efforts to create charters or, you know, make sure that low-income parents have choices through vouchers or tax credits, that that's all an effort to, quote, destroy the public institution or to privatize the public institution. And so, you know, people come at us, you know, for those reasons. But at the
base, they see the threat to their own economic. They have to provide for their families. That's their paycheck.
It is a threat. I mean, in the sense of realistically, if you come in and say, "Look, this school is not working, and what we're going to have to do is shut this school down," well, the people who are working in that school, that's going to impact them directly economically. It may also impact them in terms of their feeling about the school, the place in the community, and all that. So it's not entirely an economic issue, but the fundamentals of it are tied to economics. And that's real. And so when people resist, I mean, we ought not to be surprised that people are resisting when they see this kind of threat to their economic reality. And, it's something that we're going to have to really deal with.
Your book is about, as I said, the journey from civil rights to education reform. A lot of people may not have known that you founded something called the Malcolm X Liberation University.
Right, yeah.
And did you know him?
Actually, I didn't. Let me tell you, Malcolm changed my life in this sense. I think it was April 4th, I talk about it in the book, 1964, I think. Malcolm gave a speech at Cory Methodist Church in Cleveland, Ohio. I was in graduate school. And the speech was his infamous ballot or the bullet speech. And I actually was there, you know, for this speech. And I came in one kind of person, and I left that speech another kind of person. So Malcolm X had a very direct impact on how I see myself as a black person, as a black man, and what my responsibility is to my community. And so once I heard that speech, I began to follow Malcolm in, you know, much deeper ways than I had before.
That was after the split with Elijah Muhammad?
It was, I'm trying to remember, I think it may have occurred by then, but maybe not, because the reason why I'm a little hesitant on that is that speech was a debate with Louis Lomax, who had just written a book that was critical of the nation. And so I think Malcolm may have still been in the nation when he gave that speech, because there was a lot of response to what Lomax had said about the Nation of Islam.
I see. Just on that tangent for a second, what do you think these days when you see Louis Farrakhan speak? You have any thoughts about him?
Oh, I have great respect for Louis Farrakhan. I mean, we've been on programs together. We've talked to each other. And, you know, at the time that we formed Malcolm X of Race University, there was a lot of tension between the nation and Malcolm X because of, you know, things that had occurred. But obviously that, you know, that changed over time. And, you know, people know the history of Minister Farrakhan sitting down with Malcolm's daughter and all the things that was done to try to heal that breach. But, you know, independent of that, I've always had great respect for Minister Farrakhan, and I still do. But I'm also the kind of person is I don't have to agree with every single thing that comes out of your mouth in order for me to have respect for you. And I respect what he
discourse.
Has meant. Yeah, you know, well, it's also I respect what he has meant to the black community, and I know him personally, so.
Along the lines of connecting civil rights to education reform, you talk about Harriet Tubman and you make an analogy. What is that?
Well, you know, first of all, I think I also make the case, I don't think that this movement is the great new civil rights movement of our time. I actually don't ever use that terminology for a couple of reasons. Number one, I think that every generation has to define its own movement. Frantz Fanon wrote a book called Wretched of the Earth, and in this book he said that every generation out of relative obscurity must discover its mission and either fulfill it or betray it. And so I think that the reform movement of today needs to define itself, and that its validity doesn't come from being tied to a historical movement. Its validity comes from defining itself in its own terms. And the second reason I avoid that is because when certain people use that terminology, it creates a lot of dissension in my community, because people don't feel that these people have standing to be making those arguments. And so what it ends up doing is putting us in an argument that I don't think we even need to be in.
Hmm. And but so, you have standing to make that argument.
Yeah, but I don't make it because I don't see the movement in that way. I see the ed reform movement as an entity that should stand on its own.
Do you feel like the movement is less fractured than it used to be? And what I mean by that is that around about 5 years ago when I started doing this stuff full time, it seemed like the charter and voucher movements were to some degree more at odds with each other. There were people, there were charter people that considered vouchers wrong, evil, terrible. I hear that less. There are plenty of people still marketing this privatization concept as if it's an evil billionaires taking over the education, all of school choice is basically that. There's plenty of that still. But I see less charter versus voucher tension. Do you?
I still think there's a lot of it within the movement itself. I mean, I think a lot of the young reformers, for example, in a paper I know that Jessica Levin did, and, you know, she interviewed, you know, who would be the kind of driving young people in the reform movement today. And for a lot of them, they view vouchers and opportunity scholarships and so forth as a distraction or as a political liability. And what's really interesting is that I debated this young upcoming senator in 1998 that I had never heard of, whose name was Barack Obama. And they actually made a pamphlet out of that discussion, and it's I quote it in my book, and he called it a political distraction. And so I still hear that same rhetoric, and we have people who are charter all the time, instead of understanding that what we have in this country are three sectors. We've got for delivering elementary and secondary education. We have private schools, we have charter schools, and we have traditional public schools. If we really believe in closing the achievement gap, then those of us who believe that should say, we want to make sure that low-income and working-class people have access to all three of those sectors. And we should not take anything off of the table that would create the way for those families to be able to have that access.
When you debated Barack Obama in 1998, who won?
I did.
Something I had a feeling that was going to be the answer.
No, you can read it. I mean,
yeah,
you know,
okay.
It's in my book, so.
And that man you described, Barack Obama, has since had a Justice Department under Eric Holder who sued Louisiana to stop a voucher movement there.
Okay.
Citing that sometimes it was used for racist purposes because they'd find certain schools where a higher percentage of white kids would leave the district school than black kids or Hispanic kids leaving the district schools, even though in other places in the state that had not been the case. Now the latest is the federal judge says, well, we just need to, you need to provide data all the time, Louisiana, to the feds because we have to watch and make sure we don't see anything we don't like.
Right.
What are your thoughts on the federal involvement in a state-based voucher program like Louisiana's?
Well, I did actually write an opinion piece on that. I mean, I thought that those efforts were anti-historical and that the issue in Louisiana is not integration. And the issues that they raise and even the case that they use was a case that I think was the Brumfield case.
And the 1970s era case where it involved compulsory school assignment that they considered was being done in discriminatory ways, not school choice.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I thought what was ironic is that at the same time that the Justice Department was saying we need to do new thinking about the drug laws, that we created these drug laws 20-some years ago and we're still applying the same thoughts to something that happened back then.
Mm-hmm.
My thing to them was, you're doing exactly the same thing in Louisiana. You're coming in with a thought process from 50 years ago, trying to apply it to the current situation, and it's anti-historical. And at the same time, you know, when you would question people's ability to use a voucher to get a better school for their kids, you know, the president uses his economic reality as a family to make sure that his own children have choice, which he should.
You see that all over the country, don't you?
Well, it's hypocrisy. That's what it is.
You'll call it that.
Yeah, it is hypocrisy. I mean, that's what it is. I mean, you can't use choice for your own children and know the value of it. And then at the same time, but we can't provide that for low-income and working-class people because it's hurt the system or it would hurt integration or, you know, that to me is just hypocrisy. I don't know any other words to use. Because the reality of it is that if you have money in America, you have choice. Because if you have money and schools are not working for your children, you're either going to move to communities where they do work, you're going to put your kids in private schools, or you're going to find the most expensive tutoring that you can find, or you're going to do all three. And so at the end of the day, what happens is we say to low-income and working-class people, you got to stay in schools, even if they're failing your kids, because we don't want to destroy the system. We got to maintain the public system. And a part of the problem is that we make the mistake of equating public education with the system that delivers public education. And what I mean by that is that the Milwaukee public school system is not public education. It's a delivery system for public education. And since it wasn't created by God, we could actually change it. We could actually create a different system to deliver public education. So for me, having people have access to all three sectors is in the public interest, which is really what public education is really all about. So that whole Harriet Tubman quote that you asked me about, it ties into that in the sense that I believe that I get up every day saying, hey, you know what? I want the whole system to get better. Just as Harriet Tubman got up every day saying, you know what? I want to end slavery. But in the meantime, you know, I got a moral responsibility to, like, rescue every slave that I can. I feel like I have a moral responsibility to rescue every single kid that I can, even as you work to make the whole system better. Because, again, those of us with resources, we're going to use our resources to make sure that our kids get taken care of. And we shouldn't have an America where only those of us with money have the ability to make those types of choices.
Yeah, there's the burning school bus analogy, too. If you couldn't save all the kids on the burning bus, would you save none?
Believe it or not.
Or would you save as many as you could?
Believe it or not, I was in a debate in Arkansas several years ago, and an attorney who was an integration lawyer or something actually said that we shouldn't, if there's a burning building and we couldn't get everybody out,
let them all
shouldn't
die.
Rescue nobody. And he actually said that. And he was an intelligent person.
Well, he couldn't have been serious, right? If they literally were across the street after the event of burning building, you really don't think he would have actually said, let's save no one.
All I can say is what he said.
Yeah.
That's all I know.
Another analogy is the Obamacare analogy, where they said if you introduce competition with the government offering health insurance, then that's good for the system. It will drive down costs because there'll be competition between private insurers and a government plan that could be offered through a state-based website, that kind of thing. And they extolled the virtues of competition in selling Obamacare.
Well, to me, I've never really approached. I've talked about parent choice from the competitive standpoint. But the driving force for me has always been social justice, that it's a just thing to make sure that people who have the least get some level of help and support so they can make better decisions for their children.
Now, you know, your critics would just say, well, we're for that. That's why we just need to give more money to the existing system. We need to fully fund, which is an ambiguous term I've never heard defined.
Right.
We need to fully fund public education in the traditional public schools and fix them. Yes, it is terrible how some of the schools are chronically failing. Give them more money.
Well, I think, first of all, money is very important. I'm not a person who will make the argument that money is not important, because to me, the only people who make that argument in America got money. Nobody that don't got no money is like saying, oh, this is really cool. So I do believe money is important. But what's very important is how the money is used, and how does the money come, and what then becomes the basis for the usage of the money. And I think we ought to have a public policy that allows dollars to follow students. And so in that way, for those of us who believe in traditional public schools, as I do, for those of us who believe in private schools, as I do, for those of us who believe in charter schools, as I do, a public policy that allows dollars to follow students creates an environment where we all need to fight for quality, no matter where the school
That's
is.
What competition
we
is,
should
right?
fight for quality.
Well, the environment you describe has a name. It's called a competition.
But I think it also has a name, and that name is you want people to have freedom, but freedom is illusionary if it's freedom to choose mediocrity. So that at the end of the day, the reason why you fight for quality is because you want people to have choice. But if they only can choose from mediocrity, that's the illusion of freedom.
Which is a perfect segue to my next discussion. On Common Core, because you're a defender of Common Core, as you know, there's been a backlash.
Yep.
Some would say that, in fact, if the standards, they might agree with the standards, they'd say the assessments are the real problem that will backdrive curricula.
Right.
And so they'll say it's going to make all the schools the same. And the choice Howard Fuller talks about will be a choice between identical things.
Yeah, you know, I've heard that argument. I don't agree with it. I mean, I've seen Common Core standards. I've seen all the different ways that people can work to reach those standards. And so my view is that when you're in a state like Mississippi, and then you're in a state like Massachusetts, it's in our best interest for us to have standards that are the same. Or now, how are you going to reach those standards? You still have the ability in individual schools to determine what type of curriculum you want to use in order to meet those standards.
They'd say, though, it's the tests, though, that will then cause the curriculum to be designed around the tests.
Well, but people make that argument all the time. And my view is that there are going to be tests in America, right? The question is, what type of curriculum do you put together that ensure that kids have the ability to read, write, think, analyze, and compute, that will allow them to take a test? That to me is not the same as I've got to have my curriculum and it aligns totally with the test. What I think I've got to do is to prepare kids so that they can respond to answers on the test. So I get the debate. And the one thing I've learned, excuse me, in all of these years is that There's no public policy that only has an upside. I've never seen one. Every public policy has an upside and a downside.
And some people would find it hard to believe that a college professor, an educated man like you, a nice person like you, would block the doors of the U.S. Department of Education because the D.C. voucher program is being opposed.
Right.
You like stood there and said, I'm blocking these doors?
We're here to tell the president and Arne Duncan and the Congress that our children are our most precious gift from God.
Yeah, you know, because it's interesting, what I saw was at one point in history, you know, you got George Wallace standing in front of the doors trying to keep people out, right? At another point in history, you got people standing in front of doors trying to keep kids in failing schools. And that way of looking at the picture has always stuck with me. And so that demonstration at the Department of Education was trying to make a point that you all should be supporting the Opportunity Scholarship Program. You should be encouraging public policy that will give poor parents in D.C. the same kinds of choices that our president has. I mean, I use the Bernice King quote that the Obamas should not be the only people living in public housing that have choice. And I actually, you know, I actually believe that. And yeah. So I steal, you know, I've stole it. But I try to remember to give her credit, you know, every now and then. But I thought it was really a really crisp way of making the point.
And you won. I mean, basically, you're not you alone, but that effort to restore DC vouchers was successful.
Yeah, and we have to, you know, give John Boehner credit, quite frankly, for the position that he took when the deal got cut, you know, and, you know, I appreciate that support, you know. And again, it's one of these things where you have alliances with people on certain political issues, and you may not agree with them on a whole bunch of other issues. But in this country, this whole idea of interest convergence theory, at certain points in time, people's interests converge, even though they don't share the same worldview. And I'm the kind of person that if someone supports something that I think is important, you know, I want to give them credit for that, even though I'm going to oppose them on a whole bunch of other things.
Sure.
Because we don't share the same views.
Mm-hmm. As we sit right now in December of 2014, the Green Bay Packers are 10-3.
Exactly.
There are people that are saying Tom Brady is having a better season than Aaron Rodgers, that Tom Brady is going to be better than Aaron Rodgers. To that, you say what?
Did they see the game in Green Bay? I think it was the Patriots. I don't, you know, I'm getting a little old. My memory's a little, but it seemed like.
I mean, setting you up for that.
Seemed like. Uh-huh. There was a game in Green Bay between the Patriots and the Packers. And I think the quarterback for the Packers was this guy named Aaron Rodgers.
Yes.
And I think the quarterback for the Patriots was Tom Brady.
Right.
But I think the Packers won.
I see.
Now, again.
But they were at home. That's why.
Oh, so now what happens is if you win and you're at home, does that take that game away? I mean, I'm confused. I mean, what? But, you know, maybe some new rules have happened since I was home. You know, I've been traveling a lot. So maybe there's been some new rules that I haven't heard about. So,
Howard Fuller, author of No Struggle, No Progress, A Warrior's Life from Black Power to Education Forum. Thanks for your time and Choice Media. We appreciate it.
Oh, no. Hey, it's great to be here. I appreciate it. Thank you.